it's the emergence of consensus in the Python community. Based on the Zen of Python, there should be only one, and probably only one, obvious way to do it by Tim Peters. So if you never read the Zen of Python, you try to import this in the readable print loop. So it's a study of undocumented consensus in the Python community. So you just don't have to do it because it's a lot of time. Okay. So who am I? In a few seconds, I'm a Python core developer. I'm also translating the documentation in French. I'm teaching Python a lot in a few places, Sup Internet, le Centre de Recherche Interdisciplinaire de Paris, Machina Corpus. And if you want to find me, I'm on Twitter, I'm SizeOff. And you can write to me at julien@python.org. And yes, I have some time, the time to write some line of Python too. A little digression about the translation of the documentation. Since 1 year, almost, we have a language picker in the documentation, so you can change the language while reading the documentation. Before this, documentation were hosted in different hosts. On the meta digression, last year, for the French translation, we were at like 25% of translation, and since yesterday, thanks to the sprints, we are 32% of translation. Japanese translation is way faster than us. So what did I do? I started by crawling PyPy, Python Package Index, for some Python project. I cloned their GitHub repository, so I had like 1 terabyte of clones, and I just played with the data for some time. I did this because I was searching for answers. Human can't answer me, and the search engine can't answer too. So typically, should I use readme.rst or readme.markdown? Is there a consensus on this? Or should I use nose or pytest? Is there a consensus on this? So, likewise. Is it data science? It's not data science, it's completely biased. I only crawled from PyPy.org, and I only crawled from GitHub. So I only have 10 years of data because Git is like 10 years old, and it's only open source project. So if someone asks me, hey, can you tell me about the licenses people use? I will reply, oh, everybody is using open source licenses. Obviously, I crawled only open source repositories, so it's completely biased. Sorry about this. It's harder to crawl closed source projects. Digression, I like digressions. I use Jupyter a lot for this, so if you never tried Jupyter, please try it. It's a really cool tool. And meta digression, if you used to use Jupyter, please also try JupyterLab. JupyterLab will replace Jupyter in the future, so it's a good idea to try it now. Here's a screenshot of JupyterLab. So, as I did, I only gathered 10 years of data. If I try to go deeper than 10 years, as I have only got a few data points, it tends to get messy and unreadable, so I dropped it. Digression. I use Panda a lot for this, and if you never tried Panda, please try it. It's very cool. Let's go. README files. I see a lot of Python projects using restructured text and a lot using Markdown for their readmes. And everybody is using Sphinx for documentation, so everybody is using restructured text. So I plot this, and we can see here that since like 5 or 6 years, there's a consensus to drop readme on readme.txt. Everyone before this was using README with the extension, and we switched like 5 years ago to README.markdown or restricted text. PyPy was not handling Markdown, but yet Markdown is winning. So Markdown has a great leverage over restricted text. People are using it, even if PyPy does not support it. To confirm this, I also try to plot the commit messages. So the frequency of commit messaging containing Markdown or containing restructured text. The red one is a restructured text, so it's going lower and lower, and the blue one is markdown, going more and more. But I can hear you telling me, but PyPy.python.org does not support markdown, so I don't want to use it. Yes, but PyPy.org does. PyPy.org is, thanks to Mozilla, the new Python package index. And now you can, in your setup.py, give the content type of your long description and say, my long description is in markdown. There is a demo project, so if you want to check it, it works. So if you use markdown, please just add the content type, so it will render correctly. And if you are hesitating, please use markdown. I think people are using markdown for readme files because everybody knows markdown. The syntax is really simple. They are using it in comments everywhere. It makes sense to have something simple for a single file. And it also makes sense to use restructured text for documentation because it's easier to create links between documents. So I think markdown is okay for small files and restructured text is okay for big projects like documentation. So I don't want to kill restructured text. Restructured text is cool. Next, for requirements, I tried to compare setup.cfg, setup.py, requirements, pipfile.log. And here, it's not really interesting, in fact. We just see the little bump at the end here is pipfile and pipfile.log. So I see a thing, not everybody is committing the pipfile.log. So please commit your pipfile.log. Little regression, whoops, sorry. So for the dependency management, there is a lot of different philosophy and it really depends on what you are doing. I bet this is why we do not see consensus here. It depends on are you packaging a library or are you packaging an application? Is it public or private? Is it just a script, etc. Digression about pipfiles. Pipfile is not pipenv. Everyone is linking pipfile and pipenv together, but pipfile is from, it's just a spec from the Python packaging authority. And pipenv is an example implementation of what we can do with pipfiles. And the goal is to have a compatibility for pipfiles in pip. So do not mix pipfile and pipenv. There are two different projects linked in the present, but really different. One is the implementation of the spec of the other. And another digression in the future, we'll also have pyproject.2ml. The idea of pyproject.2ml is to choose the tool chain to install a project. Currently, we have a setup tool on these tools, and there is no choice. And using pyproject.2ml, you can say, okay, I do not want to use setup tools. I want to use Flip or anything else. So you will be able to change the tool chain, to decide the tool chain, instead of having the imposed distributed tool chain. Now, for the tests. Sorry, Nose. So if someone still use Nose, I'm really sorry, I don't know what to say. But something else, we do not see it in the graph, but with another scale, we clearly see, I do not have it here, that not everyone is testing. So also, please write test. There's like 5% of projects using tests. And here is the same graph on commit messages. So the numbers are really low because in a project, not every commit are relating to tests. But we can see the rise in blue of PyTest. So it looks like PyTest 1. Unit test is flat. Nose is dead and PyTest is rising. I like this one. Static analysis tool. I like this one too. Here, nothing is dying, and nothing won. Nobody won. Just 10 years ago, nobody was doing static analysis, and static analysis is rising, with every tools rising almost at the same pace. The yellow one rising faster than the other is Pylint, but I think it has been renamed, so it may be an artificial fast rise. And I think that just everyone starts to do static analysis. So you may should try to. MyPy is great, Pylint is great, Plecate is fast and great. So use them, they are cool tools. Also, Tox is a nice tool to run all those tools, to configure and run all those tools, so you don't have to run them manually one by one. And I also like a bit Detox, which run from a Tox file, all those tests in parallel. But Detox is kind of deprecated, and they want to merge the parallelism ID in Tox. So maybe just stick to Tox and wait for the parallelism to be merged. Two little ones about what directory are used to store documentations. And we see that from 2011, this was a mess. And boom, a consensus emerged to use a plural folder. And exactly the same for the test directory, which makes sense, I think. We do not have one test, I hope. We have multiple tests. So please use a plural name for the directory. And the graph shows also a mess from the beginning and a consensus to use a plural now. Oh, it's on this one. Not everyone is testing. There's like only 35% of people testing. So please write tests. About the fact of using an SRC directory, I think it's an inheritance for old projects in C or other languages. The most people used the SRC directory was 10 years ago, and there was only 25% of projects using SRC directories. And nowadays, almost nobody uses an SRC directory. So if you hesitate, just don't use an SRC directory, just put your project as a package in the root of your project, and it's enough. There is just very specific and little cases where having an SRC directory fixes bugs. It's typically when PyTests, when you use dunder-init files in your tests, and PyTests seeing those dunder-init files is tricking your Python pass, and it messes your test. So in this case, it fixes the bug to create an SRC directory to avoid PyTest to import your packages while running in the current directory. So no, just avoid SRC directory and avoid dunder-init files in your test, I think. About shebangs, I don't like this one because in this one, we see that we are obligated to specify Python version more and more in the shebang, and I don't like it. I would have liked to just have a Python in the shebang. But there is something great, is that the blue line, Python 2.7, has never raised. So there is no epoch in the Python history where people have decided it was a good thing to specify I want specifically Python 2.7. But there is shebang with Python 3. So it's a clear win here for Python 3. And I am happy with this. But I would have preferred to just have Python and not Python 3 in my shebang. So my preconization, it's personal. Just use Python in the shebang. Do not specify the version here. About licenses. No proprietary license here. Sorry. And if someone can explain this to me, I would really likely take the explanation, as we see the BSD license falling and the MIT license winning, and I don't know why this switch. For me, the BSD too close and the MIT license are almost equivalent. So if someone can explain me off or during the question why this switch occurred. But if you do not know which license to choose and you do open source software, MIT looks, according to the graph, a nice one. If you want a more illuminated choice, there is chooselicense.com asking you questions about what you want and showing you which license is the best for your project. Also, I discovered that if you do not put a license in your project, the Bern Convention is protecting you. So your software will remain open source. So it works too. It's called license-free software. And if you're interested about the subject, there's a Wikipedia page about it. So feel free to document yourself about this. So it's okay if you completely forgot to put a license in your software. It's an open source software. While reading tons of GitLab, I spotted also a pattern. Everyone is renaming class or class underscore to CLS. So maybe just start with CLS and not KLASS. I don't know, but I spotted this one. Next, about version in packages or modules. I see a lot of things. I see dunder version capitalized. I see version without the underscores. I've seen people using tuples. But the right one, recognized by the PIPA and the PEP8, is to use the last one, dunder version lowercase, and to give a string. So proofread your modules. You may have tuples here, and it's not the classical way to do it. And I'm only 5 minutes late, so it's okay. So if we have time for questions, I don't think so because we are a bit late, but I'm okay with questions. If we do not have time to ask questions, here's my email. And I'm on Freenode on hashpython-fr. I'm MDKR here, so feel free also to ask me questions on IRC.
So I think you didn't choose the whole of your 30 minutes, so it's only fair if you give you some time for questions.
Yeah. So I've seen a question from here and another one right here.
Well, let's...
Yeah.
Do you have any explanation why you have been to go for
that? No. It was a question I was asking. The question is... is there an explanation about the BSD three clauses falling down? And I really don't know. So if someone knows, please tell me and I'll know. And I'll try to say it next time. But no, I really don't know why. And I don't understand why MIT is winning. MIT is a great license, but I do not understand the switch between the two licenses. I personally was using BSD two clauses before.
I would bet it has something to do with Django using MIT and being one of the big actors of the Python community.
Maybe a source of inspiration. Yeah, maybe.
So we had a second question here.
Yeah. Do you know what is best to put the Russian manual in the C++ client? Do you need from STTF or the edit.py for the last step? Or is it better to put it in the edit.py?
The question is about the. I go to the slide. This one. Is it better to put a single version in the dunder init file and read it from the setup.py file, or put the version on the setup.py file and read it from the dunder init file? I did not check it for a consensus on this one. My personal usage is to duplicate the version number on the two files manually because I don't want the complex things that. Just to propagate an integer. So I do it myself. Yes? No, Taylor.
Yeah.
Oui.
Stefan.
Yeah, there's also a project named Bump Version that helps you bumping your versions. I tried it once, but I do it manually. The project looks okay. Also, if you have questions by email or ERC about consensus you would have liked to have answers to, but I did not search for, feel free to ask. If there are enough questions, I may do it again, those analyses on your topics, and do it next year with answers. So if it inspires you questions during the year, feel free to write me an email.